Well, I take the invitation, an invitation from FOR, very seriously. It's such a pleasure and an honor to speak before you. And so I took the opportunity to write a paper, which I'm going to read to you tonight. I don't like to read, but I'm going to do the best I can with it. I hope I can take it from here and get it published somewhere, because this election that we face in 2016 is extraordinary in many dimensions, and hopefully my remarks will bear upon our understanding of what's at stake. So the political rhetoric of perpetual war. I want to start with a quick overview of our present situation, most of which you already know about. For 15 years now, since 9/11, the United States has been at war. The longest single battlefield in that war has been Afghanistan, which has spanned over two administrations and has spilled over into neighboring tribal area of Pakistan. It has spanned two administrations. The Taliban remains undefeated and is gaining ground, and warlords pursue their own political and military agendas. The war, by all accounts, has been a failure. The 2003 invasion and occupation of Iraq, now almost universally acknowledged to be one of the greatest military mistakes in recent times, has virtually destroyed a country that had been created by the imperial powers in World War I. Warfare between a Shia-dominated Iraqi government and the Sunnis, now mostly controlled by ISIS, has become a struggle for territory and cities. This war has been internationalized. The Syrian civil war, which has become another international war, continues its rising death toll and propels the greatest refugee crisis since World War II. The US, British, and French air war on Gaddafi's Libya in 2011 has resulted in another failed state, an ongoing civil war, and more US and allied bombing. I could go on, insurgencies in Yemen, Somalia, northern Nigeria, the civilian casualties, the displacement. The story is not a happy one. We also have to include in our assessment of the Middle East the Israeli siege of Gaza and the essentially one-sided warfare against Hamas, culminating in the brutal assault in 2014, which has caused extraordinary suffering. The government-backed settler land grab in the West Bank makes the prospects for a just peace between Israelis and Palestinians more remote. In all these wars, civilians are the primary victims. As you also know, the US is neck deep in this descent into perpetual and proliferating war. Historian Andrew Bacevich calls it America's World War IV. The Cold War was World War III in his account. Despite repeated military failures and negative unanticipated consequences, the US still pursues the illusion that it can shape the contemporary Middle East with bombing, drone warfare, special operations, and other covert actions. It continues to invest heavily in the militaries of Israel, Saudi Arabia, Egypt, Turkey, and other US allies. American military dominance is the most fundamental fact of today's international order. The US, after all, maintains a projection of global power with approximately 300,000 troops stationed abroad, an additional 90,000 sailors and Marines at sea, occupies 760 sites in 39 countries, what the anti-war historian and critic Chalmers Johnson has called an empire of bases. Anyone with eyes wide open must come to this topic with more questions than answers. To say nothing of the burden of grief and even despair that many of us carry. I, for one, continue to struggle with both questions and the difficult emotions. For peace activists, I believe that the core political question, what is to be done, is indeed perplexing. As long as American soldiers are not dying in significant numbers, Americans, for the most part, seem uninterested and certainly uninformed about US wars and their consequences. The corporate-controlled media are of no help. Instead, they do everything possible to hinder our understanding and to provide a basis for serious debate. Historical amnesia is a particularly American affliction. Each of these obstacles are serious problems that we as peace activists need to confront. For this topic, my topic is the political rhetoric of the 2016 presidential election. Even though it is a small part of the puzzle, the rhetoric of presidential candidates reveals a great deal about the historical moment and the larger forces that shape this nation's perpetual wars. My first contention is that there is an ideology of militarism that dominates our political culture, and it is being perpetuated by both the Democratic and Republican nominees for president, despite the significant differences among them. We know how militarist ideology exploits our fears about terrorism and perpetuates the illusion that our safety depends on the worldwide projection and use of military power. We know that this ideology was developed and honed throughout the Cold War, and even after the collapse of the Soviet Union, the national security establishment had defined a new enemy to justify its continued rule. We know that militarism is an ideology that denies its own contributions to the replication of violence, including the real threats that we do experience. We also know that militarism is an ideology that defines problems in such a way to fit pre-existing solutions. The proverbial hammer that turns all problems into nails, foreclosing serious discussion of alternatives before they can begin. My second contention is that this general understanding of our situation, the situation that I've called militarism, is not enough if we ever hope to dismantle the ideology of militarism. I believe that the progress of peace activism depends on our ability to engage discourse, the discourse of militarism. The public statements of the national security elite, which are the building blocks of this ideology. We must be able to confront the ideology's essential assumptions. This is why I focus on language and discourse. It matters what is said by our political leaders, picked up by the media, and then disseminated throughout the country. The rhetoric employed by candidates is important not only because it shapes public understandings. Aspirants for office draw upon and know how to exploit a deep well of almost automatic responses by a public steeped in a culture that has come to see military power as the foundation for national strength and stature. There is much to say about this war culture of ours. Is centuries-long belief in the salvational quality of violence? The belief that the sacredness of the nation is best expressed through war and victory over adversaries, and a willingness to use whatever means necessary to protect the nation. For politicians, this willingness is a test that cannot be failed. The war culture demands strong leaders. Moreover, politicians who aspire to the highest office, I remind you of the most powerful nation with the world's strongest military, have already acquired the ideological prerequisites for the job. The ambition to become commander-in-chief entails a recognition that there is an elaborate institutionalized power structure within which they must maneuver. A president may have some latitude vis-a-vis the generals and the secret branches, but a president must acquiesce to both the substantive content of what can be said and done, along with the boundaries that one cannot cross. There is, after all, a national security consensus as powerful as any weapon. Thus, when we hear the words of a candidate for president or read the quotes, we need to ask, who speaks? Are the words the genuinely thought through positions of individual candidates who promise to shape policy to their own presidential will? Or might they be an expression of something larger? On the one side, a war culture infatuated with military power, and on the other, a confluence of forces that act with little or no transparency, what some have called the deep state, accountable to no electorate, and even to the president. Our political analysis, I believe, must recognize that the autonomy of presidents is limited. There are larger forces and influences at work. If a candidate or even a president violates the rules of the game, he or she does so at his or her political or personal peril. Donald Trump may be a contemporary example. As we will see, many national security elites, people who would normally support a Republican candidate, have openly criticized his campaign and support his opponent. I am suggesting that in matters of war and peace, there will be no deliverance by a president, even one who genuinely wants to move the US to a more peaceful foreign policy. Please note that I'm not saying that it doesn't matter who is elected in November. I think it does matter. My point here is that the language employed by the candidates for president tells us something important about the larger challenge that we face as peace activists. The ideological hegemony we must be able to pierce if we are ever to build a lasting culture of peace. With this in mind, let's turn to Clinton and Trump's national security rhetoric. I've been following the statements of Trump and Clinton that they've been making in regard to the use of military force. For Donald Trump, I will discuss just two critical positions, his America First rhetoric and his promise to vastly expand the military. Trump has said, America First will be the major and overriding theme of my administration. This means a lot of things for Trump, but my focus here will be on his assertion that national self-interest will be his principal guide for making decisions about the use of military force. He claims that he would not be guided by vague moral aims, by international obligations, or alliances. Trump's bald assertions of self-interest, an America Unchained version of national security, would make even Henry Kissinger blush. Speaking of the Iraq war, he said that even though the war was a mistake, the US should have taken the oil. After all, to the victor, he said, belongs the spoils. He has proclaimed that nations in military alliances with the US must pay their fair share of military expenditures, or the US should not continue to defend them. He suggests that Japan should defend itself against North Korea. Even though the neoconservatives, who in the 1990s touted America's unilateral moment and who called for a benign American imperium, even they were more cautious in their public announcements. For Trump, no more regime change in the name of democratizing the Middle East. That was a quote. A dangerous idea, he said. No more nation building. If a brutal dictator helps to stabilize a country or a region, let him be. Exhibit A, Saddam Hussein. Exhibit B, Egypt's Mubarak. And Exhibit C, Libya's Gaddafi. Of course, the records show that at the time, Trump took the opposite position on these interventions, or with regard to Mubarak, suggested that he be removed. Trump's criticisms of recent wars as catastrophic, along with his America First pronouncements, have led some commentators to suggest that he will return America to isolationism. It is true that Trump has declared that he will keep us out of useless and harmful wars. Here is his statement from April. Quote, I will never send our finest into battles unless necessary, and I mean absolutely necessary, and will only do so if we have a plan for victory with a capital V. War and aggression, he said, will not be my first instinct. I wish I could get the Trump, you know, feeling there and saying that, but I just can't quite deliver it. There are several things, however, that throw doubt on Trump's claim to keep us out of wars. First, note the bellicose language of his statement, a plan for victory with a capital V. From this statement alone, one must conclude that if a Trump administration takes the United States into war, he would hold back nothing in order to defeat the enemy. He has also asserted that when he draws a, quote, line in the sand, unlike Obama in Syria, he will enforce it. Most recently, at a convention of Republicans in Nashville, Trump said, quote, I'm much more militaristic than Bush or even his brother, but you have to know where and when to use it. In fact, Trump has been very explicit about where and when to use military force. As a first priority of his presidency, Trump says he will implement a, quote, secret plan to defeat and destroy ISIS. He tells us in this plan, he tells us that this plan entails, quote, a method of defeating them quickly and effectively and having total victory. The only specific thing he said about his plan to destroy ISIS was last December when he declared, talking about terrorists, you have to take out their families. Isolationism? Hardly. Trump's comment about taking out their families raises a final point that must be said about his America First rhetoric. Trump is employing rhetoric that, if carried out, would constitute war crimes. I provide just one more example, an example important to all of us who have worked so hard to end U.S. torture. Quote, would I bring back waterboarding? You bet your ass I would. It works. And even if it doesn't work, they deserve it anyway for what they do to us. Close quotes. This was said in early March in a Republican primary debate. This comment generated a firestorm of criticism from top military, CIA, and other national security elites, including elites who were deeply involved in the torture program at an early period. Especially after his remarks about purposely targeting civilians as well. Some even threatened that they would disobey such orders. Trump quickly reversed himself, saying that he understands that the U.S. is bound by treaties and laws. He also said, quote, I will not order our military or other officials to violate those laws and will seek their advice, the military's advice in such matters. Did Trump have a rare moment of insight? A belated recognition that there is, in fact, a deep state? It would take me too much time to lay out the reasons why the national security apparatus would have so much trouble with such talk, but the rebuke was clear. The media gave full coverage to Trump's reversal, but when Trump once again returned to the possible use of waterboarding in June, saying that he liked it and it wasn't tough enough, and he thinks that the law should be loosened, there was hardly any media coverage at all. Thus, his words hang out there with their whatever it takes implications. Trump's language is symbolic of a leader willing to go to any length. The dangerous implication of this kind of talk, as independent journalist Mark Danner points out, is that in the endless war on terrorism, quote, it is impossible to protect the country while also following the law. This is the very essence of the state of exception in which we find ourselves. That twilight zone between law and the raw exertion of power. Finally, in this context, I just want to note what has not been said. Neither candidate has said anything about the United States' continued refusal to join the International Criminal Court. As political theorist Paul Kahn has argued, the jurisdiction of the court has become the site for a symbolic battle between law and politics for the US, a nation that believes that politics has priority over law. In sum, my argument is that Trump's America First rhetoric in relation to war reveals an inclination towards unrestrained violence when he believes it is in the interest of the United States to exercise it. Perhaps less frequently, but certainly more ferociously. It is a discourse that has deep roots in American culture and American militarism. I also want to discuss Trump's call for what he says will be a vast expansion of the military. This is important for Trump because strength is a key theme of his campaign. He claims that Obama and Clinton have made America weak, so much so that America is now a second-rate power. He also claims that the military buildup will give the United States such overwhelming strength that it will prevent our getting into more wars. Quote, "We want to deter, avoid, and prevent conflict through our unquestioned military strength." I have a, end of quote. I have a few observations about this pledge for a military buildup. We should remember that the US already spends more on its military than the next seven countries combined. There is much to say about this distortion of humane and just priorities caused by the bloated Pentagon and now the vast domestic homeland security apparatus. Here I simply quote a famous American, and I'm wondering if you know who it is. Here's the quote. "Every gun that is made, every warship launched, every rocket fired signifies in the final sense a theft from those who hunger and are not fed, those who are cold and are not clothed. The world in arms is not spending money alone. It is spending the sweat of its laborers, the genius of its scientists, the hopes of its children. This is not a way of life at all, in any true sense. Under the cloud of threatening war, it is humanity hanging from a cross of iron." Does anybody know who that was? President Eisenhower. A lot of smart people in this audience. 1953. Trump's equation of national strength with the size and capabilities of its military, including its nuclear arsenal, is nothing new and has been used by both parties. Unquestioned military superiority has been the cornerstone of US policy since World War II and continued even after the collapse of the Soviet Union. Any attempt to rein in military spending is likely to be met with a barrage of charges of weakening America. Finally, even though Clinton has not made the claim, most of observers believe that she will also increase military spending. The military and defense section of her campaign website leads with this statement. "We should maintain the best trained, best equipped, and strongest military the world has ever known." A standard, a minimal commitment from any presidential candidate over the last 70 years. So with that statement from Clinton's campaign, I would like to turn now to Hillary Clinton. And I will discuss three themes: American exceptionalism, fighting ISIS, and Israel-Palestine. First is the idea, quote, that the United States is an exceptional nation. In late August, at an appearance before the American Legion's National Convention, Clinton said the following, quote, "It's not just that we have to have the greatest military or that our economy is larger than any on earth. It is also the strength of our values. And then she added, quote, our power comes from a responsibility to lead. In a June 2nd speech on national security, Clinton said, quote, I believe with all my heart that America is an exceptional country, that we're still, in Lincoln's words, the last best hope of earth. We lead with purpose and we will prevail. Clinton then warned that what would happen in the absence of US power. And I quote, if America doesn't lead, we leave a vacuum, and that will either cause chaos or other countries will rush in to fill the void. Then they'll be the ones making decisions about your lives and your jobs and your safety. And trust me, the choices they make will not be to our benefit. Is this Clinton or is this Trump? In such pronouncements, Clinton is very much like every preceding president, actually, along with every other member of the national security elite, including the corporate media. America, is an indispensable nation, a force for good in the world, defending values that are claimed to be universal. We not only lead by example, we lead by our principled exercise of military power. We are a benign superpower with a singular responsibility for maintaining what is called the international order. If the US doesn't lead, Clinton reminds us, there will be a void, and adversaries will fill that void. Perhaps American values translated into interests are not so universal after all. Critics point out that American exceptionalism is the ideological foundation that has led to a glib public acceptance of global military domination, along with a stubborn refusal to take seriously the abundance of contrary evidence that demonstrates that our actions repeatedly violate the principles our leaders profess. This do-no-wrong missionary zeal has long been a staple of American national identity and an essential component of America's war culture. Thus, American exceptionalism is no small thing for peace activists. Peace activists who hope to break through the blinders about American military power that most Americans wear. Given that humanitarian intervention is the latest version of this ideology, the so-called responsibilities to protect, we can expect American exceptionalism to be a bedrock of a Clinton presidency. Remember that humanitarian intervention, after all, was supposedly what the overthrow of Gaddafi was all about, an intervention for which Clinton pushed hard. The second theme I want to discuss is Clinton's pledge to defeat ISIS in both Iraq and Syria. Clinton's language has been consistent. Like Trump, she has a plan, although unlike Trump, she is willing to spell it out. Quote, we have to have an American-led air campaign. We have to have Arab and Kurdish troops on the ground. We have got to go after everything from North Africa to South Asia and beyond. This is a responsibility to lead, which she calls, and I use the phrase that you know so well, a generational struggle. Listen to her words. This is a time for American leadership. No other country can rally the world to defeat ISIS and win the generational struggle against radical jihadism. Only the United States can mobilize common action on a global scale, and that's exactly what we need. The entire world must be a part of this fight, but we must lead it. She gets even more explicit. Quote, it's time to begin a new phase and intensify and broaden our efforts to smash the would-be caliphate and deny ISIS control of territory in Iraq and Syria. That starts with a more effective coalition air campaign, with more allied planes, more strikes, and a broader target set. And Clinton added, we should be honest about the fact that to be successful, airstrikes will have to be combined with ground forces actually taking back more territory from ISIS. close quotes. Of course, Clinton has already proclaimed that there will be no American ground forces involved, glossing over the fact that American Special Operations Forces are currently active in both Syria and Iraq. A glossing that recalls the subterfuge of US advisors that was used in the buildup to the Vietnam War. Need I also point out that neither Clinton nor anyone else has expressed one iota of shame that it will be Muslim soldiers who will be losing their lives in this fight. And some, with the exception of Jill Stein, the candidates and also the sitting president, employ the language of defeating and destroying ISIS. We can expect nothing but war from Clinton or Trump. The assumption on which this is based was stated clearly by Obama when he said, quote, "The only language understood by killers like this is the language of force." My last topic regarding Clinton is Israel-Palestine. Because of time, I must be brief, mostly summarizing positions instead of elaborating quotations. Well, there are plenty of quotations. Clinton is known to be a strong supporter of Israel. Her positions over time have become entirely one-sided and uncritical. In recent years, she has, one, defended Israel's right to build a separation barrier that takes a path deep into the West Bank, an action which has been ruled illegal by the International Court of Justice, which Clinton completely ignores. Two, she has advocated moving the American embassy from Tel Aviv to Jerusalem, which she described as, quote, "the eternal and indivisible capital of Israel," understanding full well how provocative such a claim is for the Palestinians. Three, she has threatened to cut off U.S. aid to the Palestinian Authority if it unilaterally declared a Palestinian state. Four, she abandoned a former U.S. position that a halt in Jewish settlements in the West Bank is a precondition to peace talks, and she even argued that it would be counterproductive. Five, she attacked the BDS movement as anti-Semitic, an attempt to, quote, "malign, isolate, and undermine Israel and the Jewish people," close quotes. Clinton's statements helped defeat a United Methodist Church divestment resolution just this past May, pertaining to three companies that contribute to the occupation of the West Bank. Six, with strong backing from Clinton, the Democratic Platform Committee adopted language that neither referenced Israel's occupation nor expressed opposition to continued settlement building. This despite a vigorous challenge from the Sanders delegates. Seven, she put the entire onus of blame on Hamas for the 2014 Israeli assault on Gaza, and I quote, "Hamas provoked Israel in order to actually cause what we are now seeing." Finally, regarding Iran's supposed nuclear weapons program, Clinton touted her tough sanctions, hardball diplomacy that prevented war, yet she also asserted that if Iran violates the agreement, the U.S. will act to stop it, and that she will, and that we will do so with force if necessary. In addition, she has repeatedly warned that Iran continues to threaten Israel through its funding of Hezbollah and Hamas, and has threatened a tough stand over these issues. She has also praised Israel's disproportionate military responses to those threats.
In conclusion,
I hope that my brief research into the rhetoric of Trump and Clinton has been helpful. Here's what I've learned by this exercise. First, both candidates for the highest office of the most powerful and active military in the world have embraced the proposition that ISIS poses a grave threat to America and that war with ISIS is the solution to that threat. They have pledged to defeat and destroy ISIS. Thus, they confirm and promise to intensify what already is a reality. The U.S. has been at war with ISIS for some time, along with warring with other Islamic jihadist movements. What are the consequences, you would ask? First and foremost, there will be enormous civilian casualties in areas now controlled by ISIS, especially in cities like Mosul, which is the next big city that is pledged to be retaken from ISIS. There will, as I said before, also be enormous combatant casualties. Moreover, Clinton's pledge to take out Baghdadi, the leader of ISIS, will mean a continuing reliance and celebration of the powers of drone warfare, targeted assassinations with all their blowback consequences. Not least, ISIS will certainly continue and increase its attacks on so-called soft targets in the West. This, in turn, will reinforce the ongoing hegemony of militarism. This is the recipe for a forever war. Second, the consensus between the candidates extends beyond ISIS. It includes an uncritical support of an alliance with Israel, Israel's ever more extreme land grab in the West Bank, and the ongoing siege and repeated decimation of Hamas-controlled Gaza. It means continued alliances with dictators and repressive regimes that are ruthless against internal dissenters and that wage war with the U.S. or engage in proxy wars of their own, wage wars along with the U.S. or engage in proxy wars on their own with U.S. support. It means ensuring the strongest possible military at a strength that far exceeds any other country. It means, in short, that the military will continue to be an instrument of policy rather than the mythical last resort. Finally, the key differences between Trump and Clinton can be quickly summarized. Clinton is committed to the ideology of American exceptionalism. Trump is hoping to win over the nationalist, whatever it takes, xenophobic sector of the electorate. He wants to rip off this mask of justification, which has been the ideological foundation of the national security state. For this alone, the national security establishment are fearful of his becoming president. I'd be perfectly happy to respond to your questions, need for clarifications, disagreements with my analysis. I know that I've only... Myrna told me, can't you be a little bit more positive, you know? I know that I have addressed only a small part of the problem of militarism. I also invite you to discuss your own understandings of what you think is important to do, both personally and politically, collectively, at this point in our history. After all, the purpose of political analysis is to point to the enduring question. How do we respond? What is to be done? As peace activists, we continually ask what actions, what arguments, what kind of witness or protest might help shift the public mood about particular US wars and what might move people to a better understanding of the terrible consequences and incredible dangers associated with the reliance on force or the threat of force as the leading component of American foreign policy. So, thank you. Yes, sir, Mike.
So, are you implying by your talk that we should vote for either the Green Party candidate or the Libertarian Party candidates or the Socialist Workers, other than the Democrat or the Republican for president?
I thought that might be like the, one of the first most relevant questions. Actually, no, I'm not arguing that. I think that I said it in my remarks that even though the election is extremely important in many, many ways, for peace activists, the issues that we face are not going to be solved in the electoral field. Unless there is a political revolution in this country that goes beyond Wall Street. This was the huge problem, one of the huge problems with Bernie Sanders' campaign, is that on issues of war and peace, He barely touched them, and when he did touch them, he uttered rhetoric that was not that far away from Hillary Clinton, especially with regard to ISIS. Certainly around Iraq, yes, et cetera, et cetera. How people vote, you will vote your conscience. I'm going to vote for one of the militarists, and I bet you can imagine who it is, because I think the consequences of the other candidate are just too extraordinarily dangerous. But beyond that, I think that building a social movement, building the peace movement outside the electoral arena or at local electoral arena for local office, for state office, for senator, for congresspeople is the most important thing that we can do. At the presidential level, I think our capacities at this point in history, I'm not saying forever, but at this point in history are not good enough to challenge to expect much from a presidential election. Finally, the history of third parties, if you've studied them in this country, are absolutely miserable. They don't get anywhere. They never have. They're important because they are out there as an alternative, but in terms of our expectations about winning the presidency, they don't get there. So I don't know. Would you like to offer your thoughts on that, sir, or anyone else? Okay. Yes.
And I would like to know what makes you suppose that Washington State, which is the bluest of all the blue states, is suddenly not going to be blue enough to get Hillary through to being president without your vote and those of other of us who think that the time for holding our nose is over as long as it doesn't cause a catastrophe. Why do you suppose that might be the case?
Well, I understand the sentiment, and in fact, my inclination is also to, let me put it this way, to read the polls. And you've heard this position before, and if the polls show a significant lead for Hillary in Washington State, I certainly would love to vote for Jill Stein. But if it appears to be any chance at all of a close call, I'm not going to risk it.
In a moment, I'll be actually sending the basket around for contributions, but I do have 2 points. Mr. Trump is a climate denier, and as far as I'm concerned, the situation of global warming is so time critical. We don't have time to waste 4 years with a president who's a climate denier. So that would be one really important. The second one is that he said repeatedly, we have nuclear weapons, why don't we use them? And that's an everything denier. So those two reasons would bring me to say that the most important thing that we can do is really up our game after the presidential election. We have to do much more. We can't just sit back and feel bad. That is not going to work. You know, I mean, I do feel really bad. That's not going to work. And I think that for all the things that were bad about Obama, which were many, he was a lot more restrained than either of these two is likely to be, and that's from what you've said. So. Yeah, FOR, I'm sure we'll be working with other groups, but I think that the awareness that we really have to up our game in being critical of militarism and the deadly nature of it during the next president is really important to me.
You don't talk a lot about myths. You know, the myths that are necessary to propagate war. And so I wonder if you might think that the whole idea that the United States actually wants to defeat ISIS in Syria is a myth. And the reason that I say this is because, you know, I've seen this repeatedly, but I saw a really good article in Counterpunch a couple days ago, actually, and they're talking about that the administration, and with several quotes and everything to back this up, decided that they were going to take out Assad, the instant he decided that he wasn't going to go for the pipeline, the gas pipeline that they were planning to build, you know, through Syria, right? And so, and then of course, Turkey is a NATO country, and Turkey's been supporting ISIS all along. And so I don't think Turkey could do that without the permission of the United States, which basically funds NATO. So do you have any thoughts about this?
It's hard to know exactly policy-wise what it will mean to defeat and destroy ISIS. Symbolically, I think it's would be very important for a war president to claim the retaking of territory, to force ISIS out of the cities. But I think the biggest myth of all, to be honest, is the myth that military force actually works to defeat any kind of insurgency. You can defeat an insurgency if you occupy, and occupy with sufficient forces. There have been many insurgencies that have been defeated globally, historically. Although usually not for that long, they come back in new forms. Algeria was a good example. The French defeated the Algerian Liberation Front, and then just 2 years later, they came back again. So defeating ISIS, killing Baghdadi, taking Mosul back will simply disperse forces. We need another approach, and so I think we need to talk about the myth of military effectiveness in achieving political ends.
My point was that the real purpose is to take out Assad. It has nothing to do with ISIS, because the United States created ISIS, you know, and they're supported by the Israelis too, so, and also the Turks. So there's...
I don't know what to say about that. I don't have any thoughts on it, to tell you the truth. Does anyone else want to speak to that? Jane? Then.
Well, I think the real purpose of all these wars is to support the companies that make drones and airplanes and helicopters and missiles. And I don't think, you know, whether it's to take out Assad or whether it's to do this or that, that people are claiming they want to do to destroy ISIS. I think those are just excuses for continuing to take money out of poor people's pockets and put it into the stockholders of corporations that make weapons.
Could, Jane, could two things be true simultaneously, that you know, there is a military-industrial complex that generates a lot of the momentum for war, but that there are also geopolitical objectives that the United States pursues in the greater Middle East, whatever they may be? I mean, these things can, I mean, both of these things can happen, yes?
Yes, I agree. And it's important for the politicians to be strong and be popular and all that. So every one of us is a little cog in this war machine, and I include even us who are peace activists, paying taxes and whatever we do. We're all contributing to the war effort, and I'm not saying that. Everyone is aware that the overall motivation for war is the corporations,
But I think that's what it amounts to.
I was just going to say, in response to the question, what is to be done? I mean, obviously, we can try to think globally in the big picture, but I really do believe the propaganda machine is right there in your television screen. And so many of us write a check every month to the cable companies and say, take my money and keep giving me more propaganda. We used to have boycotts back in my day, in your day. Why do we continue to pay our money into the propaganda machine? I would boycott the mass media and start by closing down, you know, your cable. Now, yeah, you don't get CNN, you don't get important information that you need. Maybe the internet is a better method for gaining that information. If everybody just stopped paying for 2 or 3 months, just don't pay them, see what happens and get their attention and say, I want this change, I want to be able to select the programming and not have to pay into all of the other programs that I don't support. So I would suggest that might be something people.
You know, I have so much respect for all of the extraordinary things that individuals do and we've done collectively over the years to oppose war, going back my entire adult lifetime. The problem is, how do we get more of us to do it, right? That's the issue. How do we build a movement so that we can win people to our understanding? That is a challenging thing. I mean, it's in part an educational task. It's large part an educational task. I mean, I'm an educator, so I'm biased towards that. But I do still believe in the power of engaging directly the ideologies, of offering viable alternatives, of helping people think through what the consequences of war are, of unmasking the realities of war as opposed to what is proclaimed that we're doing, to actually show what the civilian consequences of drone warfare is, for example. I mean, all these things are extraordinarily important, but people won't listen unless somehow we can break through those blinders. And that still perplexes me. Doesn't it perplex all of us, really? It's so difficult to think about how we can expand that understanding. But I do think educational efforts are at the heart of it.
Well, one of the things that I don't think anybody's brought up, and you might know because you just sort of mentioned your education experience. When you were teaching, were there recruiters from the military on the campus? And did you or any of your students get involved in any protests about recruiting? Or is that one way to... I mean, I'm not on a campus, so I can't affect this.
UW-Tacoma didn't have an ROTC. They have a lot of veterans. In fact, often I would say 15-20% of my classes were veterans. I mean, extraordinary, and families of veterans. So I did find that teaching at UW-Tacoma, people completely broke down my stereotypes, first of all. Veterans were really wanting to talk about these things, and that they had perspectives that they brought to class that we would have never gotten without it. So there's a very veteran-friendly climate.
As young veterans, too, right?
Oh, absolutely. Oh, absolutely. Yeah, that's right. Young veterans, yeah.
So there was no recruiting, there was no ROTC, University of Washington, Tacoma, there was no ROTC at all.
I know that Fort Lewis McChord is very interested in establishing some kind of a relationship with UW-Tacoma. I don't know the details of that yet, but I suspect that that relationship is going to be advanced in some way. But I'm no longer there, but my colleagues will be, and hopefully they'll engage those issues. We have had periodic protests against war. In fact, I was just telling John and Cindy that when we opened our campus in 1990, fall of 1990, it was only 3 months away from January 1991, which everybody remembers was the beginning of the Gulf War, first Iraq War. So we laid down our credentials that we would be speaking to these issues by holding a university forum on the war. And if you recall, we were talking about this as recently as 1991, there were thousands of people in the streets against that war here in Seattle. Perhaps tens of thousands. I mean, there was a huge turnout. And if you also recall, at that time, the congressional vote about the war was fairly close. So we've descended a lot in the years since 1991. It's a changed climate. In 1991, opposition to war in the Congress was still possible. I can't see where that's going to happen today, except for minority votes. There is an effort to stop arms sales to Saudi Arabia. I know that. Code Pink is involved in that, and a few other organizations. Things like that going on. There are national organizations that try to generate support for candidates running for Congress. I'm trying to remember the names of them right now that do that. Council for a More Livable World is one of them. Others, these are online kinds of organizations. I'm sort of veering off your question about the military. Yeah, okay, so, but then I went on and on. So, more comments, please. What is to be done? Where are our efforts going in this current era?
Before we went into Iraq, there were hundreds of thousands of people that demonstrated and marched against the idea of invading Iraq around the world.
Yes, it was. 2003, you mean?
Yes. What did we want? What didn't we quite do to be able to, it was all under false pretenses. The false pretenses were actually known by the people in charge at the time. There was all this massive demonstration against it. The one thing that I really credit Obama for is that he recognized this is a Sunni Shia conflict and we have nothing to do over there. We shouldn't even be there. But at least he keeps us out. He recognizes that the populace of the United States is no longer urging for war, or were burned out on war or whatever, and therefore don't go into Syria or whatever. And he's taking a lot of flack for it, but at least he hasn't put boots on the ground. So you know that Clinton and Trump are not going to be as restrained.
So
what are we going to do? We've got to get massive, but we've got to do it somehow so that something sticks, because, media coverage wasn't very good for all these demonstrations, but there was a little bit, and enough for me to know that there was a whole lot of people around the world that were objecting to this. And we got to do something on top of that, something to make it not.
Right. You know, Iraq, the March of 2003, was only a year and a half after September 11th, right? It's interesting, Henry Kissinger was asked once what he thought about the invasion of Iraq, and what he thought about it, and he said, well, it's because Afghanistan wasn't enough. And I thought that was a really interesting answer, because what he was saying is that we could say about the American people at that time as well, that there was a strong urge to have something, some kind of retribution for the attacks. And that retribution undercut our efforts to stop that war in 2003 fairly dramatically, I think. And I think that we face the same problem. I mean, to listen to Trump's rhetoric and all the people that go for it, he wants retribution for terrorist attacks. And, Mark Danner has a new book out that I just was able to read a few chapters of before this talk, but it's called Spiral, and it's he's very good. I highly recommend reading Mark Danner. And he's essentially arguing that as long as terrorism continues, which it will. The more we use military force, the more terrorism there will be. We're facing a situation where people are going to overwhelmingly support some kind of military response to what are perceived to be the sources, even though most of the attacks are what they are calling lone wolf attacks, not organized or sent by ISIS. And there are some dramatic exceptions to that, clearly. But people who, out of various kinds of resentments, including resentments about the casualties that have been caused by bombing and drone warfare in the Middle East, one-sided warfare, right? They can't fight back there. They can't fight back. So where are they fighting back? They're fighting back with terrorist attacks. And as long as that goes on, we're in a difficult situation. I don't know how we get out of that unless we simply hit over and over again. This war making is making us less safe, not more safe. That should be a message that we just never tire of saying.
Also, it's playing right into ISIS's hands, you know, because that's what they want.
Well, it seems like a militarist on both sides want that kind of thing to go on. Nick, yeah?
Rob, do you see any signs of hope in the younger generation thinking differently? Certainly, among folks my age, there doesn't seem to be any hope ever, but amongst the majority. But in the younger, well-educated the youth who I hope have, in general, different perspectives, better perspectives.
Well, I...
That's an educational process.
It is true. You know, I went to a people's what was it called? A people's convention or something like that in Chicago in June. And it was organized a lot by Bernie people and also many unions. A lot of young people there. And again, the talk was overwhelmingly about building socialism, about economic issues in the United States. And there was one talk on intervention in Syria, actually, and it was an anti-intervention talk, which got a lot of positive response. But when I talked to people, and I talked to as many people as I could, young people, about what their understanding was, I was disappointed in how little young people knew about what was going on. And so I returned to the central proposition. We're not doing the education we need to do. Young people have learned a lot about Wall Street and about the vast economic inequality through the Bernie campaign. What a great thing that was happening with that campaign. But on issues of war and peace, we're still falling short. I do think young people have hope if we can generate that interest and understanding.
One other question. When will your message that you gave this evening, when will it be available?
Thank you for that. Thank you for that little pressure. Soon come. That's the Jamaican phrase. Soon come. Bert.
I'd like to make a couple points. One is that there has been a president who resisted the endemic culture of militarism, who actually wanted and proposed peace, proposed an end to the Cold War. People know who I'm talking about? It, of course, was John Kennedy. And in the same year that he was assassinated, maybe 6 months before, he gave the most remarkable speech that I've never heard of before, in which he proposed an end to the Cold War. And Khrushchev thought it was such a great speech, he had it broadcast to everybody in Soviet Union. Meanwhile, it got completely ignored, virtually ignored, by the American culture because we live in that culture of militarism. And of course, my understanding of what happened was the people that are for this, for all the different reasons we've talked about, were the people behind the assassination of John Kennedy. And the majority of people in the country do not believe the Warren Commission report. And I bet you that young people have a higher percentage of people who are in that category than older people. But I'd like to speak of one more thing that is unspeakable, which is everyone's been talking about the obvious fact that September 11th was an opportunity, according to everybody on every side, to, a good one or a bad one, whatever, is used to maintain the atmosphere of we have to go to war, we have to fight, but we could be in retribution, all the things we're speaking about. But there is a movement that is unspeakable, certainly in the media, the mass media, even below that, the liberal media, that young people are, by the polls I've seen, twice as likely to agree about this than older people, which is 9/11, as we're told the story, cannot be that story. Buildings do not collapse, never have collapsed because of office fires. All three of them are going down. I'm very aware, as I sit here and try and say this, that there are a lot of people in this room who will agree with me. But I think the main reason is not that they looked at the evidence, looked at the physical evidence of what happened. The 135 firefighters and first responders who all claimed they heard explosions, use the word explosion, bomb. Why in the world would these people trained to recognize explosions say such a thing? That I think we need to recognize that we are faced with a challenge. If the CIA and the military assassinated John Kennedy and Martin Luther King and others, and I think the evidence is very strong that that's the case, that the same people who were willing to kill two World Trade Centers worth of completely innocent people in Iraq, children, every month, for 8 months, according to the New England Journal, and continue, would not be willing to do something as awful and as heinous as was done, and the idea that Arab hijackers could do this. Sorry, it just doesn't hold water. And I think that needs to be seriously looked at and challenged. Difficult to say even in communities like this, but I think that's very much the root of the justification for endless war. Whether you agree with it or not, that justification is there. So, QED.
Just very briefly, Bert, if there is something that I call a deep state, not just me, then we have to ask those kinds of critical questions about what this deep state is willing and able to do. We may disagree on 9/11. I do think it's important to be asking those questions. And I also have read the Jim Douglas book on Kennedy. I think there are compelling reasons to believe that Kennedy violated that national security consensus from June 1963. And I think it was his own personal insight into the horrific consequence of nuclear weapons, a nuclear war with the Soviet Union over the Cuban Missile Crisis, that made him come to that conclusion, along with his own personal struggle with the CIA and with Curtis LeMay in the military. So, I mean, that's some very, very interesting, important history, and we need to know it. You know. Right in back of you, Bert, there was a gentleman that's been trying to...
Michael.
Yeah. For those of us who believe in nuclear non-proliferation, what would be a good foreign policy towards North Korea, which is trying to get itself a stockpile of nuclear weapons?
There you go.
Pass. there needs to be an emergency global meeting of world powers. As difficult as that, a president of the United States needs to be calling for that, perhaps under the auspices of the United Nations. And by the way, I've seen that same proposal made for the how to deal with ISIS as well, a global conference that would raise all the critical issues of that's now being waged through violence in the Middle East. Same thing with Korea. I'm not particularly optimistic about these sorts of things, but I believe it's worth the effort. What are the other alternatives at this point? I don't know. It's scary what North Korea is doing, I'll admit it. Absolutely scary. And it's also scary to me, by the way, if we're talking about the threat of nuclear war, the ongoing conflict between India and Pakistan over Kashmir. I think that that conflict could easily trigger a nuclear war as much as anything in the world today.
Okay,
I'll just disagree. I mean, I know they like to portray leaders of North Korea as crazy, but they're doing this to protect themselves from you know who have attacked more than a few countries in the last 50 years. So I know they like to be, you know, it's not a pretty country. United States.
Oh, I'm sorry, I thought you were China.
No, United States. And the geopolitical aspect you talked about, and I think you're absolutely right that it's both economic and geopolitical. I mean, our corporations only want a certain kind of capitalism around the world. You know, North Korea is distorted. It's not socialism. It's a very distorted system. But they want to protect themselves. So I think the best thing to do about North Korea is to disarm our own nuclear weapons, which we promised to do with the Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty. And if we decide we're going to spend $1 trillion in the next 30 years to get a new bomber, a whole new set of ICBMs, a laboratory, what else? Were they called nuclear submarines, and make a whole bunch of new weapons, that's madness in the face of our real security threat, which is climate change.
Well, that's what I wanted to comment on. It seems to me that there's a really serious movement of people willing to be arrested and do whatever it takes to save the earth. I think there's hope that we could really have much more success having an impact.
Does anyone know of efforts, organized efforts to make that coalition happen?
Actually, I gave a talk on that. It'll be a year ago this coming November right here. And I'm happy to say that Veterans for Peace has also recognized that connection and had a prominent articles on their website about that. And we've been working more closely with Veterans for Peace over the last year. So I think it's a very fruitful, I agree with John and with it's really a fruitful line of both analysis, education, and organizing. It's just that it's starting out, that's all. Another piece that I feel can connect with it is that by deplete all this money that's gone into militarism, just look at the Eisenhower statement. I mean, it's depleting us. A movie that I saw recently was Where to Invade Next. Just see it so that you can cry at the end. I couldn't even sit there in the circle because I was so upset. See how people who are living in peaceful countries look and how it feels, just how it actually viscerally feels to be in a room full of people from like Iceland or something. I mean, you know, we're swimming in this militarism, and it's causing, in my view, anywhere from low to medium to high grade PTSD that we find it really hard to function within. But I think that this line of organizing and thinking and everything is very potent, and I think there's hopeful signs. I mean, 3 years ago I hadn't even thought of it, and so one little article about it. So I think that there are others in other organizations who are aware of it, and I think that the key part is bringing in the health piece, because a lot of people are very concerned about their personal health, and the resources just aren't there. You know, and living in a culture like this is making people sick. Because if you're caught up in your flight or fight response and you're constantly doing that, it hurts your health. It brings you psychologically down, brings you physically down. And so it's a cultural health issue that I think there again, the people that, the moms that are concerned about their kids, all this, I think that there could be some really good organizing that could begin to really bring things together in a much more comprehensive way than we've done so far. I think we've just begun, I guess is what I'm saying.
Building alliances has always been important in organizing. I think often about the militarization of policing in the United States is another line of connection. Any good alliance, of course, has to be two ways, and we can't just get people for our particular cause. We have to really think about how we support their causes.
Well, thank you, Rob.
Thank you.